Brothers, welcome to the feast. Tell me, which among you will be the first course?
The Horus Heresy would mark the damnation of humanity as 1,000 wars across 1,000 stars plunge the galaxy into ruin. Heretics, tyrants, and psychotic murderers would be unleashed across the void in their endless rampage in service to the fell powers of the warp. Yet among such despots, a select few would hearken millennia of suffering in their wake as their bloody deeds corroded the very fabric of what it means to be human. For today, we shall elucidate the undying champion of the being known as She Who Firsts, the Scion of Chemos, Lucius the Eternal. The Emperor's children would, despite their legacy, burn among the brightest legions of the burgeoning Imperium. Drawn from the noble houses of Terra, conquered by the Master of Mankind, the sons of these proud bloodlines would comprise the ranks of the founding of the Legion of Aristocratic Warriors. Disciples of the virtues of perfection, poise, and nobility, the early years of the Third Legion would be characterized with the favor of the Master of Mankind as his heralds of his glorious future. Bedecked in gold and purple, the Astartes of the Emperor's children would endure many hardships prior to the reunion with their Primarch, Fulgrim, their legion coming close to total annihilation with the catastrophic loss of their gene seed to a viral outbreak, and would draw new recruits from the homeworld of their Primarch. Chemos, a barren mining world bereft of the grandeur of Holy Terra, would renew the Third Legion with aspirants hungry to prove their worth and exceed the deeds of their forebears. Among the dirt and grime of the dismal world, a youth of immense potential would be inducted into the Emperor's favored sons, Lucius. A handsome man, possessing immense talent in the art of swordcraft, Lucius would swiftly earn recognition within the command hierarchy of the Third Legion. Obsessed with the attainment of mastery of the blade above tactical acumen or command strategy, Lucius would hone his skill in duels with his brethren to earn glory. Prior to his induction within the Legion, Lucius would mark his sparring partners among the rabble of Chemos with scars during their practice duels and slay a number of Chemosian beggars to test his abilities. Decried for his disregard for both life and limb in the practice cages and beyond, Lucius's cruelty and egomaniacal tendencies would be tolerated by virtue of his skill at arms. Contemptuous of those unworthy to match his talent, Lucius would toy with his peers and grovel with his tutors in hopes of gleaning new lessons and mentorship. Despite his innumerable flaws, Lucius would spend every waking moment honing his understanding and mastery of swordsmanship. Competing for dominance during the tournament known as the Golden Blade upon Chemos, Lucius would defeat every one of his opponents before competing in the final battle for the title of champion. Facing an opponent twice his age, whom had earned championship twice over, Lucius's abilities would be tested to the limits. Uncontrovertibly the better duelist, Lucius would be winded by a dishonorable strike from his opponent's knee and seek retribution for his opponent's base attack. Dismembering the former champion limb from limb, Lucius would achieve victory at the cost of the outrage of the tournament onlookers. Storming the arena, further blood would be spilt as the crowd attempted to overwhelm Lucius. Yet a hulking, shadowy figure among the crowd would save the young boy. A sergeant of the Third Legion, the Astartes would observe Lucius's battle prowess and deem him worthy of recruitment within the Emperor's Children Legion. An opportunity that Lucius would accept with gleeful pride. Imbued with might befitting an Astartes, Lucius would survive the many surgeries and trials to ascend to the stature of a Space Marine. Training daily through honor duels decreed by the Legion sergeants, Lucius would revel in his besting of his battle brothers and dominance of the practice cages' blade machines. achieving a string of flawless victories within the cages prior to the Feast of the Emperor's Blessing. Lucius would earn glory within his legion as the only legionary to achieve such a feat in its history. A paragon of the legion's uncompromising zeal for perfection, Lucius's deeds would be recognized by the 3rd Legion's Lord Commander, Eidolon. Installed as the captain of the 13th Company, Lucius would sate his unquenchable thirst for battle in service to the companies of the 3rd Legion. His arrogance, now exacerbated with his promotion as the 13th Captain of the Legion, few senior officers outranked his stature. Ever feeding his ego with glories made by the edge of his sword, Lucius would persecute the Great Crusade not for the betterment of mankind, but for the elevation of his own legend. His skin unblemished by a single scar, no opponent's blade had ever claimed a mark on his skin. Yet such a claim would soon be tarnished. Garviel Loken, 10th Captain of the Sons of Horus Legion, would spar with Lucius and break his septum with a strike of his fist an instant after the commencement of their duel, ritually scarring his chest as the only mortal being capable of injuring himself with a blade. Lucius's morbid obsession with self-mutilation would exceed new heights of depravity, shaving his scalp and making deep cuts into his face. Lucius would refute the teasing of his legion for his handsome features, unbefitting a warrior of the Legiones Astartes. Equating pain with eminence, Lucius's masochistic tapestry of wounds would prove to be an ill portent of his future. For the dawn of the Horus Heresy loomed, and Lucius would soon decide the allegiance best suited to his own selfish goals. Few of friends, Lucius would, despite his glaring deficiencies in personality, attempt to befriend disparate elements of the Emperor's Children's expeditionary fleet. Forming a fractious brotherhood with the commander of the 3rd Legion's 10th Company, Saul Tarvitz, the level-headed captain would identify Lucius's flaws in hopes that the young upstart would overcome his failings. Befriending the duplicitous Remembrancer, Serena de Angelis, the Slaanesh corrupted mortal, would reveal her own scarred forearms, signifying the death of her peers, such as Leopold Cadmus, whose blood she now used to illustrate her paintings. Lucius was no longer perfect in visage, and with encouragement from his degenerate peers, would horrifically scar his face after its disfigurement by Garviel Loken, marking his flesh with a notch for each worthy opponent joined in battle. Lucius's skin would be the canvas for his debased tally of foes. With the betrayal of the Emperor's Children upon the surface of Istvaan III, Lucius would join the loyalist 3rd Legionaries in their defiance against the Warmaster's forces. Yet in secret, Lucius would confer with Lord Commander Eidolon in orchestrating the destruction of the loyalist defenses from within. Turning on his loyal battle brothers, Lucius would butcher his allies and confront his once friend, Saul Tarvitz. Fueled by jealousy, Lucius had come to resent Tarvitz's command of the loyalist survivors during the 3-month defense of the Coral City. Unable to best his battle brother in the ensuing duel, Lucius would flee the battle in disgrace. Tarvitz would presumably die upon the surface of Istvaan III, forever denying Lucius the chance to best his former brother in battle. Reinstalled among the traitor contingent of the 3rd Legion, Lucius would seek self-inflicted penance for his inability to slay Saul Tarvitz. Participating in the dropside massacre of Istvaan V against the loyalist counterattack of the Iron Hands, Salamanders, and Raven Guard, Lucius would join Lord Commander Eidolon in leading the vanguard into the heart of the loyalist forces. Dancing through enemy lines with phenomenal skill in swordsmanship, Lucius would carve a bloody path through the ambushed Astartes of the Loyalists. Earning glory for his legion with their overwhelming victory against the Loyalists, Lucius would return to his legion to find his Primarch changed. Fulgrim had slain his brother, Ferus Manus, upon the Urgal depression of Istvaan V, yet found the taste of victory over the Gorgon to be bitter. The Phoenician had gifted Lucius the demonic sword, the Leia Blade, for his deeds at Istvan. Yet his erratic behavior was not in keeping with his regardless, changed demeanor. Disobeying the orders of the Warmaster, Fulgrim would order his legion to assault the Mechanica mining world of Prismatica V. Lord Commander Eidolon would question his Primarch's orders, and for his provocation, be beheaded by the Phoenician. Pouring the blood from his severed head into goblets of wine, Fulgrim would order his inner circle of senior officers to drink the crimson concoction as a sign of loyalty to his will, to which the deviant Emperor's children would agree. Seeking answers for his liege's change in personality, Lucius would investigate La Fenice, the Grand Theater, aboard the Third Legion's flagship, the Pride of the Emperor. Above the central stage of the theater, Lucius would observe a golden frame painting with Fulgrim imposed before the Heliopolis gates of the flagship. Seeing horror within the eyes of the illustration of his glorious gene father of such illustrative skill that no mortal could capture such an otherworldly depiction. Convening the Brotherhood of the Phoenix, including Chief Apothecary Fabius Bile and First Captain Julius Caseron, the Sons of the Phoenician would confront the imposter wearing their Primarch's skin. Subduing him at great cost, the Brotherhood of the Phoenix would bring Fulgrim's body to the Apothecarian and conduct the exorcism of their gene sire. Misinterpreting their Primarch's condition, Fulgrim would reassume control of his body and reveal his deception against the demon of the Leia Blade. Using his captivity to learn and understand the workings of the ruinous powers, the Phoenician would return to his gene sons with bountiful knowledge of the beings of the warp. Knowledge which would further damn the Third Legion. With the demon of the Leia Blade now trapped within the portrait of La Fenice, Fulgrim would command the Emperor's children to join forces with the Fourth Legion, the Iron Warriors, in their venture to the world of Idris. Seeking the Angel Exterminatus within the deepest depths of the Eye of Terror, the Eldari Croneworld of Idris housed a power beyond mortal comprehension. The origin of the birth of the being known as Slaanesh, Fulgrim would claim its remnant power of the Sepulchre of Isha's Doom within the citadel of Amanisha Kalis. Seizing such power, Fulgrim would achieve apotheosis to become a demon prince of Slaanesh, yet a planetary defense force within reach of the Eye of Terror would stand in the path of the 3rd and 4th Legion in their venture to the Crone World. Hydra Cordatis would attempt to stall the traitors from their prize, yet be no match for the Astartes of two legions. Yet with the intervention of the Shattered Legion Warband of the Sisypheum, the Loyalists would attempt to cripple their advance. Lucius would lead his men in fighting the Black Shield Warband, yet be confronted by the Raven Guard survivor of the Dropside Massacre, Nykona Sharokin. Dueling in single combat, Lucius would initially be invigorated to find an opponent worthy of slaying. Yet with each subsequent clash of their blades, Lucius would realize his error. Sharokin was more than a match for Lucius, and would bury one of his blades deep within his side. Missing each and every attempt to counter his foe, Lucius would be slain by the son of Corvus Corax. Finding no pleasure nor pride in his deed, Sharokin would drive his blades deep within Lucius's hearts and lungs, severing arteries and irrevocably damaging his organs. Death would claim Lucius, yet through the machinations of She Who Firsts and the Spider of the Third Legion, Lucius would not relent to the whims of Oblivion. Reborn through unknown means, Lucius would awaken upon the Medicaid slab of Fabius Bile. The traitors of the Horus Heresy had failed in their rebellion against the Imperium, yet Lucius cared not for the ambitions of those beyond his own gain. Transforming into a terrible creature driven only by the pleasures of mutilation and thrill of combat, Lucius would ascend to become the chosen herald of Slaanesh. Indulging in orgies of slaughter, the champion of She Who Firsts would not relent in his pursuit of perfection and mastery of swordsmanship. Transcending death itself in pursuit of his obsession, Lucius would compete in the contest known as the Scarlet Blade and face Lord Commander Sirius of the Emperor's Children in battle. Wounding Lucius with his ornate power spear several times over, Lucius would delight in his pain at the hands of his foe. Seemingly bested, Lucius would be bludgeoned to death by the martial prowess of Sirius until nothing remained but a bloody pulp upon the sands of the dueling arena. Yet as weeks waxed and waned, Sirius would undergo a hideous transformation. His ornate power armor now bore depictions of cackling demons, his hair had fallen from its root, and his eyes now glowed with a purple hue. Scar tissue formed on his skin, much to the delight of his despicable legion. His screams became laughter, until Lucius's form grew from the Lord Commander's mutated form. Fulgrim would smile to see his favored son reborn, and install him as the rightful Lord Commander of the Legion in Sirius's place. Bearing a curse upon his foes, any who slay Lucius the Eternal shall become host to his rebirth. Yet it is said, should any foe who slays him take no satisfaction in the kill, Lucius shall be denied his rejuvenation and be condemned to sleep forevermore. But until such a stalwart foe shall succeed in the deed, Lucius's foes shall adorn his armor of shrieking souls as their twisted forms languish in never-ending agony. Unleashed upon the galaxy at the head of his own warband for 10 millennia, Lucius has wreaked untold misery and torment across the stars. Armed with the lash of torment and Leia blade, Lucius seeks foes worthy of his prowess in battle, in his quest to become the greatest duelist in existence. Slain by many foes, Lucius regardless rejects the embrace of death time and again. An affront to both creation and his Imperium, the innocents of the galaxy plead for salvation against the relentless monster born of pride, ambition, and vanity.
All beings experience hunger. That persistent reminder of mortality, that blooming hollow inside all, which affirms that only by taking from without and devouring within can we extend our coil. Hunger is universal for those who are destined to die. As they feed, they pay the incremental bribes that forestall its coming.
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. The Blade of Eons is among the Imperium's most hated foes, for his existence remains a constant reminder of the failing of humanity and its once cherished legion. Yet take heart, for such malignant enemies of the Emperor shall never escape his judgment. They shall merely forestall their demise at the hands of his most venerated champions.